Welcome to a recent interview that I shared with the local alternative care practitioner, Todd LeCesne, who I really think of as an absolute futurist. That is, someone that is taking full advantage of the synergistic potential of conventional healthcare and cannabis therapy. I hope you enjoy. You mentioned the role of CBD, obviously, which has gotten a whole lot of popular attention, and it seems to be hailed as kind of the savior or the redeeming quality of cannabis. You know, I can say that in our data sets, we do show that CBD seems to be statistically and directly associated with improved outcomes in real time, but only for a handful of conditions. What we actually find is that THC seems to be a stronger therapeutic player in the big scheme of things. Now, with that said, I cannot discount all the anecdotal evidence that I hear from people that are using these common and commercially available legal CBD products that swear by them. So I guess what I'm hearing is that perhaps a safe or responsible method of practice is to suggest some of those so-called non-psychoactive products initially and just see how the patient responds to those.
So in medicine, Western medicine, when you say start low and go slow, mm-hmm. you think of you have to crawl first, then you can walk, then you can jog, then you can sprint. And I think that that's a safe way to approach initiation of any kind of medication intervention, even supplements, for example. Cannabidiol is on a great run right now. Mm-hmm. Sister compounds like cannabichromine and cannabigerol are also showing equally as efficacious outcomes, and for different conditions, if you will. And this is where the research is needed to be able to add better specificity for each of those particular molecules and give patients a better starting point with regards to, hey, here's what you presented with. Here's what we would think would be a better molecule to help to intervene with that particular condition. There are so many different variables affecting the patient's tolerance for this particular medicine or their acceptance of the medicine physiologically. Okay. I've also seen cultural things that I think are really important with regards to whether or not people perceive benefit to whatever the therapy would be. Okay. My Hispanic patients, for example, seem to get great results with just a single 200 okay. milligram ibuprofen.
They're real, okay.
You know what I mean? They're not taking, you know, on my side of the desk, they're not taking anything. Yeah. And there's a distrust, I think, in the Hispanic community. And también, you know, mi segundo idioma es puro español. And yo estoy muy contento hablando en español con la gente también. Y todo está pensando que yo estoy un mexicano o brasileño también. So this is really common for me, Hispanic culture, and I'm completely, you know, enwrapped and enveloped in it. My wife's a Latina from northern New Mexico, and I, you know, didn't take any medications growing up. And her mom was a curandera and used to give, her grandmother rather, was a curandera, used to give medications, etc. And I think that your familiarity with medications has a whole lot to do with whether or not you perceive this thing is helping. I see some populations that have, you know, overindulgence, if you will, in pharmacology, and they're taking hundreds of pills and tens of pills or whatever it is for whatever conditions and things like that. Whereas some populations, they haven't taken anything forever, and you give them one single ibuprofen, they're like, holy smokes, that really helped a lot. Okay. And I think that some of that is also the case with regards to cannabis for patients that are saying that this CBD really helped me a lot. You know, maybe you're not too, you haven't utilized anything, and now you're utilizing this for the first time and getting pretty good anti-inflammatory effect with it.
Thank you for watching this part of our interview. We truly hope that it helps as many people as possible, including some of you practitioners out there that are still open-minded and want to be able to utilize as many tools and resources as possible to continue to enhance the well-being of your patients. If you appreciate the content that we're bringing you nearly every single day, please consider hitting the like and subscribe buttons or sharing these videos with your friends and family. Consider becoming a Patreon to this channel or even a donor to the University of New Mexico Medical Cannabis Research Fund, where we are working very hard conducting cutting-edge research every single day using all kinds of different types of research designs, working with humans, animals, large data sets. We do it all, and we're working really hard essentially to improve the well-being of our community. Through these efforts, collectively, together. We're starting to feel it. We're changing the world. You mentioned the role of CBD, obviously, which has gotten a whole lot of popular attention, and it seems to be hailed as kind of the savior or the redeeming quality of cannabis. You know, I can say that in our data sets, we do show that CBD seems to be statistically and directly associated with improved outcomes in real time, but only for a handful of conditions. What we actually find is that THC seems to be a stronger therapeutic player in the big scheme of things. Now, with that said, I cannot discount all the anecdotal evidence that I hear from people that are using these common and commercially available legal CBD products that swear by them. So I guess what I'm hearing is that perhaps a safe or responsible method